Hello, and welcome back to Gunfighter Life. Today, we are very blessed to have a great episode. I think it's going to be entitled The Definitive Guide to Scout Rifles. A little fun history, a full circle. The very first episode of Gunfighter Life was on Scout Rifles, and this guest contacted me about it several years ago. So I think you're really going to enjoy a great episode today. I'll plug into the bio. You can skip around 3 minutes 45 seconds past where the bio starts to get to the end of it if you want to skip it. First and foremost, I am a servant of God, a teacher, a preacher, a fisher of men. God is number one in my life, and everything that I do in this podcast is no different, and I don't apologize for that. A little bit about me in the background. I grew up, I guess what you would consider a heathen, didn't grow up a Christian, but I grew up in the southeastern United States, what most would consider very poor. Hunting and fishing and shooting. Joined the Marine Corps at 17, did a couple of combat tours in Iraq. After my combat tours in Iraq, I was an urban warfare instructor for the United States Marine Corps under Mojave Viper. I also served in law enforcement for several years in LAPD. I worked patrol assignments and more specialized assignments, where by God's grace, he got me through some nasty places in this world of war zones and some of the nastiest streets in the country. Not because I am better, because God chose to have mercy on me and had a purpose for me, and I'm thankful for that. After my time in law enforcement, I was a private contractor for federal government, for a three-letter government agency I won't specify, doing private contracting work. I'm very much involved in guns and gunfighting. I also served in the U.S. Army, both full-time and part-time National Guard. I should say my primary MOS is in both branches of the military or infantry, as of one sort or another. Specialized infantry in the Marine Corps and an MOS that no longer exists. I started competition shooting even before I joined the Marine Corps at 17. I won my first gold medal even before I joined the Marine Corps at 17. I've been blessed by God with the talents he's given me to win more shooting competitions than I can remember. I've won most of my competitions in rifle and pistol, but I've also competed in archery and shotgun and even muzzleloader, knife throwing, hatchet throwing. I've competed in all that. I've also been a professional big game hunter and guide. Like I said, I grew up hunting and fishing and shooting. I've done it to put meat on the table because I like to put food on the table with the talents God's given me. I don't apologize for that. I've done it as a professional hunter and guide. I've slain all manner of beast and guided for all manner of beast. Bear and wolf and elk and deer, mule deer, white-tailed deer. I've slain ram and fallow deer and countless animals. And I don't apologize for that either. FBI certified, firearms instructor, NRA, and a bunch of other three-letter government agency certifications. Blessed be the Lord, my rock, who trains my hands for war and my fingers for battle. Psalm 144. I've been blessed to be the commander of a tactical team, an SRT, special response team, in a large metropolitan area where our primary job was to stop active shooters. But again, first and foremost, I'm a servant of God, called by God to share the good news, a teacher, a preacher, a fisher of men.
All right, so it's my pleasure to introduce today Steve Clifford. All right, Steve, well, if you want to go ahead and introduce yourself and talk about who you are, and just if you want to just generally introduce who you are.
Sure thing. So, yeah, my name is Steve Clifford, and I have a YouTube channel where I discuss a lot of different things, but mostly it centers around the Scout Rifle. I have a blog. I participate in a lot of online forums and such, but it's all based upon firsthand experience with the Scout Rifle, and I've got more experience than a lot of people. And I'm not going to say I'm the most experienced, the most talented or anything like that. I'm far from it. But I am one of those that I'm a I'm a consummate student, and I try and learn everything that I can, and not just learn it, but put things to the test, try it out, see how it works, evaluate it, try and figure out this particular scope. What are its strengths? What are its weaknesses? What did I have a problem with, and how can I fix that? So I am a consummate student, and I started all of this back when I was in college in 1990. I read To Ride, Shoot Straight, and Speak the Truth from Jeff Cooper, and it changed my life in a lot of different ways, but it really helped me form what I thought would be a good idea in terms of hunting. I didn't grow up in a hunting tradition. I grew up with parents that instilled in me a lot of thoughts about freedom and liberty and rugged individualism, but not hunting. And so when I moved to Virginia in 1991, I wanted to hunt. Mm. And Cooper's writings really helped me form what I thought made sense. I couldn't afford a scout rifle in the beginning, but I eventually had a scout rifle built. And then I bought a Steyr, and then another Steyr, and another Steyr, and have modified Steyrs. And I started trying to figure out, you know, how much time have I spent in the field? And it's a lot. And I've probably taken, you know, upwards of 100 to 120 deer, and then various other creatures, not all of them with a scout shaped object, some of them with a muzzleloader, but a healthy portion of them with a rifle. And my type of hunting isn't just sitting in a tree stand, because honestly, I get bored.
Yeah, I'm with you there. That's how I grew up hunting. And I'm with you there. I'm a spot and stalk and a still hunter for sure. Sitting in a tree stand is not. Sometimes I will do it because I know it's the best way to get that deer, but it's not by far my favorite. Not at all.
No, I get bored. And so I'll start skulking around the, you know, field edges and pastures and little woodlots. And I end up pretty successful like that, but that style of hunting is really well suited to a fast handling rifle with a proper sling and a low power scope. It works out really well.
Agreed. Yeah, I guess let me jump in a quick second. Let me tell you how I kind of hunt. And so I mentioned in the bio, I'm a professional big game hunter and guide. Not right now. That's not my main full-time job, but it has been before. Mm-hmm. I grew up hunting. I've hunted a lot of different ways, but my main go-to way is, I think, similar to yours. And I hunt with very light, handy mountain rifles, generally mm-hmm. Kimbers, and based on the pre-64 Winchester action.
Yep.
And I do a very low power scope, what most people consider way too low for deer hunting. I mean, like a 1-4, a 1.5-5. And it's not a scout scope, but that's generally how I hunt, with a sling, obviously, for the same reasons. That's how I hunt. So pretty yep. similar, if not a scout rifle.
Absolutely.
Do you want mm-hmm. to mention your blogs and your YouTube channel, which I am subscribed to and I do watch, but I thought mm-hmm. maybe you'd mention that. So sometimes people listen and they actually have time to go and check stuff out. So maybe they want to check that out while they listen.
Well, the blog is, it's a Google blog, and I don't even, it's Blogspot. I think if you just search Cliffy 109, that's C-L-I-F-F-Y 109, you'll find it. And then on YouTube, just look Steve Clifford Scout Rifle, or if you put in Rhodesian Sling or Ching Sling or Steyr Scout, you'll stumble across me there.
Okay, and I can put a link in the show notes to your channel as well.
And a word of warning about the videos. I like to think that the content is pretty good, and people tend to like the content. My I don't have video editing gear, so it's a one take. The audio is a little rough. It's not fancy. The production quality isn't great, but I like to think that the content is pretty decent.
Yeah. So the same with similar with your YouTube channel and my podcast. Like yep. I said, I don't think anybody listens for the audio quality.
Well, yeah, I get that. So, but then the other thing that I'll mention, fair number of training classes. With I took one from the Steyr Academy. They used to have a scout rifle class. It was a two-day class down in Alabama, and the instructors for that were Mario Marchman from Gunsight and Richard Mann, who literally wrote the book on scout rifles. He's a man that was given access to all of Cooper's personal writings, and he dug through all of that and put together what's called the Scout Rifle Study. So no man knows more about the Scout Rifles than Richard Mann does. And I got to take a class from him, which was really fun.
That is great. I'll be honest, I didn't know that book existed. I might have to check that out.
Oh, you'd love it. He does mention the Rhodesian Ridgeback in it. You'd love it.
Oh, but, yeah. I got mine napping right a few feet from me right now. So,
yep. So,
and then what other training classes, sir?
So, twice I have taken Randy Kane's practical rifle class. And Randy Kane was one of Jeff Cooper's instructors back in the day. He has a 3-day class. He usually offers it down in Florida, and it is phenomenal. He will teach you to run a hunting rifle like you wouldn't believe. He will teach you to fight with a deer gun. You'll learn, you know, the fundamentals plus weapon manipulation. Like, it's one of those things, you don't know what you don't know. And you take his class and you're like, oh my goodness, I didn't realize I could do that with a bolt gun. Great stuff. And if you take it during the winter, it includes a twilight and nighttime portion, which is worth its weight in gold. It is amazing. You'll learn to hate scout scopes in that.
Yeah, a lot of people don't train enough at night or in low light, for sure.
Yep. And then twice I have also taken Tom Russell's class. And Tom Russell was an instructor with Jeff Cooper, and he is one of only 6 men to ever have been conferred the title of master instructor from Jeff Cooper. And only 2 of those people are currently still instructing. So pretty rare opportunity. And he is teaching a 5.5-day class. It's the original Jeff Cooper curriculum, and he's teaching it at the Whittington Center out in New Mexico on the Jeff Cooper range. And oh my goodness, what you will learn there. He includes, you know, everything from 25-yard snapshots out to ring and steel at 500.
Oh, wow.
You'll do some competitive drills against the other students. There is a, twice you'll get to do what's called a rifle walk, where you're walking through this little sendero and there'll be targets anywhere from, you know, 10 feet out to a couple hundred yards, and you've got to find them and engage them. It is just an amazing class, and I've done that one twice. So in addition to the formal, and by the way, both times I took it, I did earn my expert ticket from him, which I'm fairly proud of.
Awesome.
And then I live on a farm now, and on the farm, I've got the ability to put up a kind of a woods walk range, where I've got steel targets through the woods anywhere from, you know, 50 out to about 190 yards, where it's all improvised shooting positions. There's no shooting benches. You're using trees and stumps and roots and everything else.
That's great.
To really get, you know, field experience out of these things. So that's kind of my training resume, I guess.
That's great, sir. That's very thorough. So most of it has been gun sight affiliated, is that correct, in some way or another?
Well, yes, but I have never been to gun sight. I haven't taken a class there. That's, I would love to, but haven't had the money or the time to be able to do that one.
I get you. I live pretty close to there too, and I was also, when I was in Vegas, I was a front sight shooting instructor, which I don't generally mention in the bio, but that's like the other big rival. That's the other big school. I would love to go to Gunsight, because I also have read at least parts of that book of Jeff Cooper. And I really like a lot of the stuff that he did. And I think it would be awesome to take a class at Gunsight again, if I got the time and the money. I think that would be fantastic.
Well, maybe you and I'll do a scout rifle class out there someday.
I would have to get a scout rifle first.
Well, that's the cool thing. You don't have to. And that's the one of the misconceptions, especially like with Randy Kane's class. Randy Kane isn't so much a big fan of the scout rifle. To him, a Model 70 Winchester with a hinged floor plate magazine and a 1.5 to 6 power scope and a Rhodesian sling, you show up to his class with that, that's all you need. And yeah, frankly, if you showed up to Gunsight with a Kimber with a similar type of scope, you could run that. You could absolutely run that and do well. So that you don't have to go the full bore scout rifle to take full advantage of it.
Gotcha. That's awesome. Okay. So let's roll into I guess I have it pulled up, but if you wanted to, you probably know my memory. Do you want to kind of give a, whatever you want to do first, like a philosophy of the Scout rifle, and then maybe just the bullet points, like a Scout rifle is 6.6 sure. pounds, you know, et cetera.
Yep. So yeah, what is a Scout rifle? That's the big question. And that's kind of a hard question to answer because variety of things, but what Jeff Cooper developed was a general purpose rifle. He was looking to make the ultimate general purpose. And he pointed out that it's very easy to specialize. If you want to make a varmint gun, you can make a varmint gun. You want to do a combat rifle, you can make a combat rifle. You want to make a, a woods gun, make a woods gun. Specializing is easy. Generalizing is not. So he wanted to figure out his best solution for a true general purpose rifle. It's, you don't know what you're going to encounter. You don't know what or where or how you're going to encounter it, but you know that you're going to need a rifle. That's the only thing you know, is you need a rifle. So he set out to develop that. And that means that, you know, the Scout rifle is his solution to a general purpose rifle. That doesn't mean his is the only solution to a general purpose rifle. You can come up with your ideas for a general purpose rifle, and if it makes sense, do it. If you build off of what the foundation that Cooper laid, do that. It might not at the end of it be a Scout rifle, but it could be one heck of a general purpose rifle. And so that's where I think a lot of people get wrapped around the axle, or they say, well, this is a Scout rifle. Well, no, it's not. It's a great rifle. It's a fantastic rifle, but it's not a Scout. And the example that I use is, you know, somebody shows up with a SIG P320 and they say, look at this. I've got a polymer frame striker fired combat handgun. Don't I have a cool Glock? And say, well, dude, that's not a Glock. Well, you're just old school. You won't change. You won't evolve. This is my Glock. Well, no, it builds off of the Glock. It actually does some things a little bit better than a Glock, but it's not a Glock. Don't call it a Glock, call it whatever it is, but it's not a Glock. And so I kind of take the same perspective with the Scout rifle. You can build and develop something that meets your needs, and it might even be a better general purpose rifle, may or may not be a Scout rifle, but who cares? Just build your gun and have fun, you know?
Yeah, got it. And then so, I guess that's a good place to run into the bullet points. So what is, like, what are the bullet points for a Scout rifle?
Okay, so Jeff Cooper wrote 5 different versions of the bullet points. So there's a little bit of deviation there. And the biggest point of departure is the weight. He wrote 3 kilograms, 3.2 kilograms, and 3.5 kilograms, which translated as 6.6 pounds, 7 pounds, or 7.7 pounds. But
it's a big difference.
Well, it is, but you got to realize, so in the Scout rifle community, we kind of view that as, you know, good, better, best. If you can get it down to 6.6, get it down to 6.6. If you can only get it to, you know, 7.7 all in, well, that's still pretty good, because that weight has to include all of the accessories. That includes an empty magazine. It includes the sling, muzzle device, scope, mount. If you're going to be running with a flashlight all the time, it includes that. So everything that you're going to add to it is included in that 7.7 pounds. So that's where, you know, that's the weight deal. And trying to get a gun with all of your accessories to make weight is a trick. It really is. So there's a weight, there's a length, no more than 1 meter in length. Had to have a backup iron sights. Ghost ring sight was a requirement.
I like that.
Cooper was very distrustful of scopes and variable power scopes in particular. He did not like them. And so he specified that the scope that was on it would be mounted in front of the magazine well. It would be a low power, depending on which reading you said, anywhere from a 2 power to a something under a 3 power magnification, with eye relief of between 9 and 11 inches, and fixed power. Bolt action, great trigger, 308 caliber, Bipod was one of those things nice to have, but not required. Stripper clip loading or detachable magazine. He also specified that it have some form of a magazine cutoff so that you could load one and shoot one. But all of this was predicated around the idea this was the general purpose rifle for the individual gunman. This was not for conscript troops. It wasn't for it's not military. A infantryman's rifle. It was for the lone gunman.
Got it.
So those are the bullet points on
that's
on
this. Great, sir. Did we cover caliber?
Well, no, but I will. So yeah, he specified 308, but he had a couple of caveats built into that, and some of the caveats that he built in actually contradicted each other. So at one point, and he was very clear about this, is that it was not only a 308, but a 308 that could throw a 150 grain bullet to 2,700 feet per second. He considered that to be the baseline.
Yeah,
it had to be able to do that, which if you look at it, that means that you have to have at least an 18 and a half to 19 inch barrel. If you go shorter than that, you're not going to do that. So he set forth the performance parameters, but then he also said that in places where military cartridges are illegal, that a 7mm 08 would be acceptable. And for somebody who is very recoil sensitive, a 243 is acceptable. So he did put those in there. He wanted to make sure, and he specified 308 because he knew that that was a caliber that you could pick up anywhere. If you were in Africa, if you were in Montana, if you were in Canada or Alaska, and you walked into a hardware store, they've got 308. They might not have 243. They probably won't have 7mm 08. And a lot of that, this current ammo apocalypse kind of proves up the wisdom of that. Even if you look on some of the websites like Ammo Seek,
308's there.
308's there in large quantities for cheap. 6.5 Creedmoor, it's there, but it ain't cheap. And it's trying to get enough to train with, no.
It's funny you say that. We're still in the ammo apocalypse. When I was a professional hunter and guide, and I've done a whole episode called The Guide's Rifle, and it was a go-to 6.5 Creedmoor. And I switched. I bought an almost identical rifle with a detachable magazine because I wanted that feature. But I got it in 308 just for that reason, because I already had a bunch of ammo for 308 because it's a crossover military caliber for my tactical rifle. And because, like you said, even now, that's one of the few calibers I can go on Ammo Seek. And I can get 150 grain, probably 168 grain. I haven't checked this, but I could probably get 180 grain. And I could get it, and it's available. I could get it right now. I could have it shipped to my door in a couple of days.
Exactly. So that's, and again, the wisdom of Cooper's wisdom on that really made a lot of sense. So should be a 308, but he had some wiggle room built into that.
Gotcha. And he did not, as I recall, he did not specify bolt action, although we almost exclusively think of scout rifles today as bolt actions.
Well, yeah, he did specify bolt action. Oh. But again, this was one of the weird little things. He said he's not opposed to a semi-automatic, but nobody made one that would meet all the other criteria.
Yeah, gotcha.
And this is actually a point of contention in the scout rifle community, because Richard Mann, when he wrote his book, he said, yeah, he did say that. However, he also wanted to make sure that this was a general purpose rifle. And by general purpose means that you can use it in Kentucky and Wyoming and Arizona, but you can also use it in California. You can use it in New York State. You can use it in Canada. Can you use an AR-10 in those places?
Yeah, that's true. I would argue that that shouldn't. I would argue that you should be able to. But you're right. The fact is that you can't.
Right. Can you cross state lines? Can you cross international lines with it? And it's a, you know, he hunted Africa so much that Africa is really the one place that he always looked to say, all right, can I use it there? If I can't use it there, then it's not general purpose. But you know what, in the scout rifle community, the semi-auto question is an open question. There's a couple of guys who have built using AR-10s. They have made some very lightweight rifles.
I think that you can make, I think that you certainly could, if you set out as that, that being your goal and weight criteria with like carbon fiber, free float tubes and, you know, a super light, like A1 butt stock. I think that you certainly could achieve that weight goal for sure. And the accuracy and a very good accuracy goal with an AR-10.
Yep. Yeah. So there's guys who've done it. They get very defensive when somebody says, well, that can't be a scout rifle. And they've got a point. I mean, Cooper did say he was open to it. So, although
now, what about lever actions? I guess the only other one would be like a pump action, which are super uncommon. The 7.6 is the only one I know, but what about lever actions? What about like a Henry Long Ranger or a Browning BLR?
I think both of those would make excellent platforms for scouts. They both need a little bit of work to get their weight down and they need some work on scope mounting. But yeah, BLR is a little bit irritating because apparently you can't disassemble that thing without sending it off to a gunsmith to get it put back together for you.
Yeah. If you've ever disassembled a lever action, trust me, you want to send it to a gunsmith.
Yeah. So got a little bit of issue there, but you're right. You're dead on. I think. And Cooper liked lever actions. He wrote about it in an article called The Carbine Compromise, which I think if I remember correctly, he wrote that in 1966. And he talked very fondly about the fast action, fast handling, the fact that you could top it off without unloading it, without removing a magazine, without opening the chamber. You can top them off.
Yeah.
So yeah, he spoke very fondly of the Winchester 94.
They're a great gun. Yeah. And yeah. I think 30-30, while it's not a 308 with a good loading, especially today with the Spitzer bullets that you can load with the soft tips, you know, you can get you can get to a 243 level for sure. Maybe not out of 500 yards, but at 300 yards, you probably could do all right.
Yep.
And not to get too in the weeds, but Browning does make the BLR in a lightweight. I forget what they call it. They may just call it the lightweight, but they make one in 243 and I think 308 that's pretty light. I've looked at getting it just for that reason. Because I'm, like I said, a spot and stalk hunter. I like to walk a lot. So, but they do. But not to get too in the weeds, we'll get off of that though. We talked about semi-autos. And then, so I think a lot of people listening to this that know about the Scout will know about the companies. And you may have know of more than this, but I jotted it down. The Steyr, which you mentioned, which would probably be the preeminent one. The Steyr, the Ruger, and the Savage.
And Mossberg, yes.
And Mossberg. Is the Mossberg MVP a Scout? Or do they make a Scout?
They call it a Scout.
Oh, okay. Does it have a four-mounted scope?
It does.
Oh, okay. So it is a Scout. Okay.
Yep. It's heavy. And there's some weird issues with the Mossberg in terms of how the action is joined to the stock. If you put too much torque on the thing, it's going to break the stock, and it doesn't have a real solid bedding block down there. But
it's
decent. It has one appeal in that, if I remember correctly, I think that one uses M14 or AR-10 mags. I have a very strong preference for double stacked magazines. I hate AICS magazines. Everybody else seems to be so crazy about them. The long range community, everybody else thinks I'm wrong. Fine, I'm wrong, but geez, I hate those things. I find them cumbersome, clunky. Whenever I'm in a class with people that have them, I watch them fail constantly to insert them properly. They are fumbling with it. It takes way too long and you can't top them off through the ejection port.
Yeah.
You've got to drop them out. People say, well, then just do a tack load, put in a fresh mag.
Carry two. Yeah.
Well, yeah, but
if you're hunting, that makes a lot of noise.
You know, I'd rather just stuff in, you know, if I've only shot two rounds, I'd rather open up the action and stuff in two more.
Yeah.
But that's
okay.
Everybody says I'm wrong on that.
Let's do the Ruger versus the Steyr. That'd be my big question. Cause if I was looking at getting a Scout, those would be the two that I would look at, the Ruger versus the Steyr. For Steyr's obviously been around a lot longer, but what do you think about the Ruger versus the Steyr?
My preference is strongly for the Steyr for a few reasons, but the Ruger's not bad. As a matter of fact, if you get a synthetic stock Ruger, I would, if you know what you're doing and you're comfortable with that magazine, that's a pretty good setup. I don't like the magazine, but if it weren't for the magazine, That's a really nice rifle, and it's a controlled round feed, which means that it's a very robust system for
that would be my main selling point. That would be my main selling point tipping me to that, because I like Steyr. They make a lot of good stuff. They make quality stuff, but I like controlled round feed from my years in hunting. Controlled round feed to be as nice. I like that, especially if something or someone is trying to kill me. I like that.
Yeah, you should read the Scout Rifle Study. That discussion is brought up a lot, and
I bet
Richard Mann quotes a lot of African hunters in talking about why that actually isn't quite the big deal that everybody thinks it is. But the some of the advantages to the Steyr, the stock design on the Steyr is one of the most underrated things. That stock, it has a negative drop at the comb. And what that means is under recoil, the comb does not hit you in the cheek.
That's nice.
As it recoils back, it actually drops away from your face, which means you're not feeling the recoil as much. Mm-hmm. It has the most sublime trigger you will ever try. It has the lock time on it is next to nothing. You press that trigger and it's just a little click. Nothing moves, but that click happened, where with the Ruger and frankly, just about everything else, when you pull that trigger, it might be nice and crisp, it might be nice and light, but you have this thunk where you can feel the firing pin flying forward. And it's just enough to where when you handle the Steyr, you're like, oh my goodness.
Okay.
Then there's the magazine, and the magazines are expensive. They're $50 a pop, and I own a boatload of them. They're worth it. And they're double stacked, which means you load 5 rounds in it, put it in the bottom of the gun, and it's flush to the bottom of the gun. Having that flush mount magazine makes the gun handle better. It makes it feel better. It's easier to get into certain shooting positions if you're, all contorted, trying to use a stump as a shooting rest as you're in a jackass prone position. Worry about a magazine hanging under the gun. It's a difference. So I like the Steyrs better, but the Ruger is not a bad choice. I do like the Ruger, and I would never look sideways at somebody that chose the Ruger.
Do they make the Steyr in stainless?
No, just clean it.
That would be a big thing for me. Is it chrome lined barrel or is it just phosphate or whatever it is?
I actually don't know.
Okay. That would be a big thing for me, because I've had guns rust on me before, especially when I'm on a long wilderness excursion in some nasty weather, Pacific Northwest. Stainless is nice. I know a lot of hunters don't like it, but I kind of like you, everybody disagrees with you. I really like stainless for that application, or a chrome lined barrel, because if the outside of the barrel rusts and the inside's pristine, I don't really care as much.
Yep. I don't clean my guns a whole lot. I am not one of these clean freaks. When I go to the shooting classes, putting 600 rounds through the gun, I might clean it once during the week. I'm pretty hard on my equipment. And
gotcha. And even down in Florida, you've never had your guns get rusty or anything like that?
No.
Okay. No. Well, that's a good testament to the Steyr finish, then. I guess they solve whatever problem that is. There's a lot of good finishes out there, nitride and stuff like that. Yep. They may have solved that problem 20 years ago.
Yep.
I just know I'm not a big fan of the old traditional blued steel barrels, unless it's for like tradition, but for a hard times hunting implement, it's not for me. I guess the other big advantage of the Steyr is it does, like you talked about, have that single round feed, which I really like that feature for a couple of reasons. I don't know if you ever do this, but especially when I'm hunting out west with a 308, I have in the past have two different loads, like my 130 grain solid copper and screaming fast velocity that I'll use for most of my hunting. But if I get into like a creek bottom or a riverbed where my longest shot is 50 yards, then I'll throw in a 200 grain, soft pointed lead bullet, just because the difference in point of aim, point of impact at 50 yards for those is academic. And that's a much better bullet for punching through stuff and dropping down like a black bear at 30 yards. So that single round feed to me would be nice, because I could just take one out and put it in without having to switch magazines. It'd be noisy and everything else. Tac reloads are great, but they're not quiet.
Right.
Yeah, that's one thing if you're running on a range. It's another thing if you have a deer in the area and you've been stalking him for 3 hours and you got to do a mag change. That would suck.
Yes, it would.
So, yeah. I like it. I guess we've covered the things on there. What about the, do you have any experience with the Savage Scout rifle?
No, I don't. They're a little on the heavy side. I mean, I've seen them, I've handled them. They're a little on the heavy side. Nothing wrong with them though. I mean, they're good rifles. I think they use a proprietary magazine. I'm not positive on that, but I think they do.
Well, the thing about the magazines, a lot of things, I'm not sure about the Ruger or the Savages, but a lot of guns, you can get different stocks with different bottle metal adapters where you can put in, you know, an AR-10 magazine. So that would be something to look at and into. I imagine they make it for the Savage because a lot of tactical guys run Savages. So,
And although you get a Savage and start replacing stocks for different bottom metals, you may as well have just bought the Steyr to begin with. But
yeah, that's a good point. That's a good point. But I would imagine you modify your Steyr after you get it quite a bit.
I modify the heck out of my.
Yeah, I figured. Like you're talking about the lock time, but you can just get a super heavy extra, like a super extended firing pin spring for the Remington, or not the Remington, but the Ruger. I imagine they make one that would give you quite a bit of less dwell time, lock time. But I don't know. But I did, like I said, it's academic to me because I don't own a scout rifle. I do know that Savage, I will say about their other rifles, everyone I've ever shot has been ridiculously accurate. And they tend to be cheap, which if for somebody that it might be better for somebody to get that this year than dream about the Steyr for 3 years because they just can't afford it. You know, they get that whatever it is, I don't know, COVID check, and they're like, oh, I got $600. I can get a Savage, but I can't get the Steyr.
Absolutely. So,
and the one thing I will say, I've handled the Savage Scout, and I don't like those iron sights that are on there. I forget what brand they are, but I've run those even on a 22 and broken them and knocked them off. So
I think they're William.
And I don't want to bash William sights, but that particular one, like, it doesn't have any wings. Nothing's protecting it. And I drop my rifles. It's not uncommon. So I would probably change out the sight on that when I could. Yep. But I guess if you have a scout scope on it and the scout scope kind of covers the back of that, so it's not going to get dropped on, maybe it's okay. As long as it's not your primary sighting system, I would trust a variable power scope more than I would trust that iron sight, just from my experience. But I've broken both, but I think that would be a little bit, especially with today's optics.
Right. Yeah. And optics are the other thing that we can go way into the weeds if you want. And that's,
I don't want to get way into the weeds on them, but if you can discuss what your go-to scout optic is, I guess before that, let's discuss why the four mounted optic in the first place, because a lot of people that have grown up in the past, you know, have gotten into shooting in the past 20 years, they look at that as something arcane, and discuss that, why the four mounted scope, why it's a thing, why it was a thing, and then maybe your favorite scout scope.
So that scope was the reason for it, and it still works extremely well in certain situations, and the certain situations are in at a training range. If you have a good idea where the target is, or if you're in a training class like Cooper ran all the time, oh my goodness, they are fast. It takes advantage of a trick of your brain. Because that scope is so far forward and the ocular, the rear lens is so small, when you bring the gun up into your field of vision for that snapshot, you're just focused on your target with both eyes. As the gun comes up, both eyes are still looking at the target, but because it's only 2.5 power magnification, your brain is able to process that, accept it, and let you see your whole field of view, but just with this one little magnified section with the crosshairs in it. At the last instant, before you press the trigger, you just focus on the crosshairs, press the trigger, and you've got an amazing snapshot.
Nice.
It works great, and it works great in the field as long as your target is not camouflaged or moving through shadows. If it is, you learn the weakness of it. Is because that scope is so far forward, and it is such a small part of your vision, trying to find, you know, minute little target indicators, little details, you know, the flick of an ear, the flat of a back. If that deer is in cover, you can, or concealment, let's say, and concealment can just be shadows. You can't see the stupid thing. And as the sun, it gets worse. In that Randy Kane class, the first guys to drop out at dusk are the guys with the scout scopes.
Gotcha.
Every low power variables are the big thing, and a lot of people are using them. And I switched to a low power variable for quite a while, and I liked it a lot. It solved the issue of, you know, twilight and camouflage targets and all that kind of good stuff. But I found it to be in the way. I just didn't like having that ocular lens so close to my face, especially if you're doing a snapshot. You've got a brimmed cap, which most people are wearing, you know, some sort of a hat.
Yeah.
You've got to get it up underneath the brim of the cap. It irritates me. It gets in the way.
I'm glad you brought that up, because that was one of the questions I was going to bring up at the end, but it's a good place to discuss it now, is that I like low power variable optics. I like them a lot, because especially a good quality one, you can run it like a red dot when you bring it down to true one power, if it is an actual one power scope, and you can crank it up if you want. And it's one piece of equipment. And I get why Jeff Cooper distrusts stuff, just like I tend to distrust stuff with batteries.
Yep.
But it's come a long way. It's kind of like the red dots on a pistol. The optics of today are so much more advanced than than the optics of even 10 years ago were.
Yep.
So you've run both, and you still prefer the Scout to the LPVO?
Well, no.
Okay.
There's a middle ground there. But unfortunately, somebody at Loophole continued this scope. They made what was called the VXR Scout. And that thing had an eye relief of about 6 inches, which is longer than a conventional scope, but considerably shorter than a true scout scope. It splits the difference. And that was a 1.5 to 5 power with some really good glass. I ran that at the Randy Kane class, and I was able to shoot way past legal shooting light. I was able to see and identify targets. I actually tied for first place in that particular drill, because I was able to stay on the line for longer than anybody else.
Loophole, did it have an illuminated reticle or no?
It did. It was the fire dot reticle, 1.5 to 5. It checked all the boxes. It was perfect. And so, of course, they discontinued it. They still have what's called the VX Freedom Scout, which is a 1.5 to 4. Still the 6 inches worth of eye relief. The glass isn't as good as the VXR. It does not have an illuminated reticle, but it's pretty good.
Yeah.
It's pretty good. If I were setting one up today and I didn't have access to this VXR that I do, I would be hard pressed. I would have a tough time deciding between an LPVO and the, that intermediate eye relief of the VX Freedom. I would have a tough time deciding.
Yeah, I would second the Leopold. Leopold's my go-to optic. Leopold and Trigicon, they're my go-to optics. And especially something like that, Leopold's hard to beat. And it's American-made. So if you can get American-made, I always encourage that. If something else is literally better and might save your life, I say do what you got to do. But if you can get American-made and it's good, I would recommend it.
Yep, same here.
So let's see, what have you messed with any of the other ones, like the Burris or any of the other options out there? I know there's several companies that make them.
Yep. I at one time had a Burris 2-7 Scout. I got that thinking that I could solve some of my target resolution issues with more magnification.
Yeah, but you give it up on the front end when you got close targets, I would think.
Well, yeah, and the light gathering, the quality of the glass, and I'm actually in the minority. Richard Mann loves that scope.
Okay.
I just found it to be inadequate. I would take an LPVO over that Burris any day, but I have people who disagree, very knowledgeable people who disagree with me on that.
I have a lot of people that dissent with a lot of my opinions, which is fine. Like I said, there's a certain particular way I hold a handgun that a lot of people are like, that's crazy. But it works for me. And I would never tell somebody that's the way you have to run a handgun. You run it the way that works best for you. You try it. And if you don't like it, throw it away. Just like any training class or anything else. But I get that. Does Steyr actually make, they don't make optics, do they?
No.
Okay, so they don't make their own scout scope.
No, for a while you could buy one with the Loophole 2.5 power scout scope already installed on it. Okay. But Leupold also discontinued that scope.
So check eBay for those two scopes, huh?
Right, exactly. It's crazy what they did there.
I gotcha. Okay. I mean, to be fair, I think not a lot of people, I guess we would call it gun culture 2.0, people that didn't grow up reading Jeff Cooper or, you know, Death in the Tall Grass or Death in the Long Grass. You know, a lot of people didn't grow up like that. And you said a lot of people don't grow up hunting. To them, shooting is Glock 19 and AR 15.
Right.
And I think that's especially in the last, 5 years, that's a giant, giant chunk of the market.
And I'm glad they're here.
Yeah, I'm glad they're here too. That's fantastic. But
I don't look down on those choices. You do you. You know.
Yeah, and I have Glocks and I have AR-15s. I mean, I'm not going to put them down for that either. I hope that eventually they will you know open their eyes a bit wider and see that you know guns can also put meat on the table and they can also be used for a lot of other things. And there's more than you know shooting fast on Instagram, and there's more than you know how fast you can do a mag change. And don't get me wrong, I like those things too. I've done quite a bit of competition shooting, but there's more out there than that.
Right. Absolutely.
I didn't come up with this. I took it from somebody else.
Jack Spearco, the Survival Podcast, is where I think I originally heard, where I heard this original version and then personalized it, I guess.
But it's a good saying, but I don't remember exactly how they said it, but can count on both hands the number of gunfights I've been in my life, with two wars and going to Iraq twice and all that other stuff, and being a police officer in LA. I can count the number of gunfights I've been in on two hands and have fingers left over, but I can't recall the number of times I've had to eat.
Yep.
So the odds of me needing a gun to eat is far higher than the odds of me needing a gun for a gunfight. Even if that number goes up by a factor of 10, it's still more likely I'm going to have to eat and put food on the table with a gun than I am to need it for defense.
Yeah,
I think the scout rifle is a nice balance there, even though I've never owned one.
Well, and one of the things Cooper said is that the scout rifle is one of those things that when you just handle one in a gun store, you're not going to be able to really appreciate just how good this thing is and how effective it is. You've got to get out into the field and use it. And once you do that, then you realize what you didn't know. It really is just a joy to carry, a joy to use. And if you take a class from, you know, Tom Russell or Randy Kane or somebody, your skill set is just off the charts, and it's fun. It just works so well.
Gotcha. And so real quick, before we get too far away from optics, this was something that occurred to me and I didn't put it in the notes. We haven't had a chance to think about it, but if somebody has a more modern gun, they want to be scoutish with, and they have a rail, which a lot of modern guns have rails. Like we talked about gun culture 2.0, even a lot of bolt actions comes with a rail. Would a red dot and a magnifier be a viable option? Like a 2.5-3 power magnifier that they can flip back and forth, because a red dot's fast and handy. And then you can flip over and have the fixed magnification.
Well, maybe I would probably go with an LPVO instead of that.
Me too. I would too. I don't honestly like that setup, because to me, less is more, the simpler, the better. And I like one optic more than two optics. I like two lenses better than four lenses. I agree with you. I just didn't know if you thought it was a viable option or not.
I mean, somebody can certainly do that, but I would want one rather than two. And you've got weight and bulk and mounts and everything else that can go wrong. The fewer things that can go wrong, just do that.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I just wanted to know if you thought it was a viable option. And I do think for somebody that's building an AR-10 and wants it to be scoutish, I think it would be a good option, for the simple fact that they may already have a red dot and it would just be an easier transition.
With
an EOTech, it has its advantages, because even LVPOs, even good ones, even they have some kind of eye relief standard.
Right, they do.
A red dot basically doesn't. I mean, it's a lot easier to shoot, even though I'm right-handed, to shoot left-handed with a red dot than it is with an LPVO. So they do have some advantages.
Yep.
At least for me. So, but I'd agree. I would go with the simpler is better too. And especially with as good and as far as LPVOs have come recently, I would stick with that option. And then the next thing we haven't covered, and I think you and I are going to agree on, is the importance of a good sling. And I guess talk about the different kinds of slings for the scout rifle and then why they're important.
So when Cooper started this whole thing, he discovered that he wasn't the first one to come up with this idea. called the CW sling. And the CW sling was just basically taking a regular sling and or a carry strap. And instead of it being a carry strap, he moved one of the swivels up to a mid position. So you had a mid position and a front position, and then you'd loop your arm into that. And the loop that that creates, because it's around your bicep and then it wraps around your forearm, it locks your forearm into place. So your forearm is absolutely rock steady. You can get a very, very good supported position as long as your elbow is rested on something. If your elbow is rested on your knee or on the ground or shooting bench or anything else, you've got a good solid lock to the gun. Really does improve your accuracy, your ability to hold it steady, I should say.
Yeah.
And then there's the Ching sling, which accomplishes the exact same thing, but without having to move from one sling position to the other. It's a sling that has the loop built in plus an extension off to the back so that you can carry it over your shoulder like a conventional carry strap. And then the new one is what's called the Rhodesian sling. And the Rhodesian sling was developed by a guy named Andy Langlois. I think that's how you pronounce his name, but Andy from Andy's Leather developed this sling. It's basically a big loop that goes off of your front swivel stud, and then it has an extension back to the rear swivel stud. So you don't need an extra swivel stud in the middle. And with that, you can use it as a carry strap. You can throw it over your shoulder and carry it either American or African style. But then when you're ready to use it as a shooting aid, you stick your arm through that loop and then wrap into the sling, and it accomplishes the exact same thing that those other two slings do for you. So you don't have to modify your gun. You don't have to add an extra sling swivel, and it gives you the stability of a genuine loop sling. You've got to have a loop sling, though. A hasty sling doesn't accomplish the same thing. It doesn't lock your forearm like a loop sling will do. So
I should actually try that for my rifles, because I really like hasty slings. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I don't have any experience with a scout rifle, or don't have any experience with a Ching sling or Rhodesian sling, but I have quite a bit with the more traditional slings. I cut my teeth competition shooting with, mm-hmm. you know, three position and four position. Back then it was four position. I think they took one out, you know, precision mm-hmm. rifle shooting.
Yep.
But not the kind we think of today with the 20-pound rifles where you go and put it on a rest, where you shoot standing, kneeling, sitting, and prone. And right. If you don't have good sling work on that, you're not going to win.
And like, you probably use the old traditional, you know, the 1907 with the keepers and all that kind of good stuff.
Exactly. The old leather military sling with the two prongs that you would adjust for each position and mark it with a Sharpie or something. Yep. Even we even had like little brass holders, and we would tie it around our bicep and loop our bicep in between there. And I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. It loops the mm-hmm. front, and you can, like you said, if you know how to use a sling, you can get mm-hmm. ridiculously accurate with a good sling. And I think that's something we talked about gun culture 2.0, that they're like, well, I'm just going to shoot targets at 5 yards. I don't need a sling except for a single point sling. And then if I'm going to shoot precision, I'm going to shoot with it off a bipod or a tripod, even, you know, a big camera tripod with a 20-pound rifle. And I think they miss that, especially in hunting or a lot of other situations. It's the in-between where the sling really comes into its own, where I don't have to take a shot right now, but I also don't have 5 minutes to get set up either. I may have, you know, 8 seconds by the time the deer walks between this open position and the other side of the road, and he's gone. And for that, a sling is nice, as I'm sure you know.
Yes. And so this is where I've actually kind of developed some techniques on this one, but that's why the Ching, the Rhodesian sling, they allow you to have it as a carry strap, but it locks your arm in, maybe not quite to the degree that old military 1907 sling did, but it's close.
Gotcha.
It locks your arm in much, much better than anything you could ever do without an actual loop. So a loop sling is important. And by the way, Wilderness Tactical makes a nylon version of the Rhodesian. And if I remember correctly, Magpul even has a new sling out that has a similar type of loop arrangement for very, very cheap. But they're all kind of based on that Andy's Leather Andy is the one who came up with this whole Rhodesian thing. But so one of the things that I've done and kind of gotten known for a little bit in the scout rifle community is the idea of carrying the rifle with it already looped up. So I will loop into the sling. I'll get my get the sling up on my bicep, wrap my forearm around it, grab the fore end of the gun where I'm completely looped up into the sling. But then I'll rest the gun on my hip and I'll walk with it resting on my hip like that. Or
I was going to ask, do you actually walk with your arm in the sling like that?
Absolutely.
Okay.
And what's cool about that is that my forearm at that point is actually not supporting the gun. I can let go of the forearm and use my binoculars and everything else because the weight of the gun is actually both on my hip and on my bicep, because my bicep is what's has the loop around it. That's what's holding the gun in position.
If you aside, and we can edit this part out, but if you have a picture of that, you know, send that to me. If you have a picture of you doing that or what that looks like, send me one of those and I'll make that the picture for the show note, or the picture that goes with the podcast, because that would be a pretty cool thing to see.
Absolutely. And I actually, one of the YouTube videos that I did, two of them, I've given a pretty extensive demonstration on how that works. And the reason that I do it that way is, as I'm skulking around, I might see a deer pop out the edge of a field 130 yards away. I got about 3 seconds.
Yeah.
And doing an offhand shot, probably not going to work. That's not steady enough. But if I drop to my knee or even drop down to sitting, I can drop down to sitting very, very quickly. I'm already looped up. I'm already as steady as I can possibly be. I don't have to go messing around looping up at that point. I'm already looped. I'm already ready to go. And I can take that shot from a much steadier position because I was hiking around with it looped up.
Yeah, I agree. I would just caveat that with, or I just add on to that with, when I was a professional guide, that was one of the most common things I would hear is I just didn't have a shot. And I was thinking, you had a shot. You were just slow.
Yep.
Like, if you knew what you were doing, you could have shot that thing 4 times by now. But you think that you need to get in a prone position with a rest because that's how you always sight in your rifle. And that's not how we hunt. Like when I did it, I almost exclusively spot and stalk hunted or still hunted. Mm-hmm. And you had the shot. You had a shot. You just weren't fast enough to take advantage of it. And I think that either that sling or any kind of sling work, like we said, in the in-betweens makes a difference. If you're sitting in a tree stand in the same spot for 4 hours, and I'm not putting that down if that's how you like to hunt, then the chink sling's probably not for you. Or the Rhodesian sling's probably not for you. Or if you're, you know, doing failure drills at 3 yards, chink sling's probably not for you. But the in-between with the actual hunting distances where he might pop up at 50, he might pop up at 150. You know, I don't know. You know, so I think the sling is a really underutilized thing in I guess the last 10 or 20 years. I guess I was blessed that I came up in the competition shooting arena back when a lot of people were still doing that discipline with the sling. And yep. I still use it today. I still have one of those old military slings, and I would use what you call the Hasty sling. And I practice, you know, carrying the gun on my shoulder, both muzzle up and muzzle down, and going very quickly from that to a Hasty, like spinning it around and getting it into a Hasty sling, which can be done pretty quickly. But what you're saying is it's not as stable as a chink sling or a Rhodesian sling.
Correct.
That's pretty cool. And I guess one more question, and you may not know the answer to this. Do we know why Jeff Cooper called it a scout rifle?
Yeah, the individual and having that one rifle where he's out scouting and hunting and being a true scout back in the late 1800s.
What was he envisioning as a scout? Was he, because I think of like an Old West guy that goes out in front of the platoon and is like a forward observer. And that's my vision of a scout, just because been a military man. Is that what he was envisioning, or was he envisioning like a lone hunter out in the wilderness, or both?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I got you.
Yes. It was the scout. It was the guy that is going out scouting in Indian territory. The guy that is scouting for explorers. He's the guy that is the forward observer. He is not the infantry. He may need a shot, but he might need to move. He might need to pack up and scoot real quick. So volume of fire was never the priority. It was being able to move and shoot when you needed to. But yeah, absolutely. It was that Old West scout. And he's also in Africa. They mentioned a lot of African scouting that was accomplished back in the day by explorers for very much the same reason.
Yeah, that would be a good rifle for that. And then another question. So let's say that for whatever reason, you have to grab one long gun.
Mm-hmm.
You have to grab one thing, one gun for you're going and you don't know if you can come back. You don't know for how long. You don't know what you're going to have to do. Is that gun a scout rifle?
100% for me, yes.
Okay, all right.
And, you know, I've thought about this a lot, and I own, you know, I own a Galil Ace, I own ARs, I own all FALs. I used to build a whole bunch of FALs. But if I have to grab one gun and I don't know how long I'm going to be out, I don't know what I'm going to need to use it for, I don't know any of that. I know that I can accomplish a lot more with a scout rifle and 50 rounds of ammo than a lot of people can do with an AR-15 with 240 rounds of ammo. I can be quicker with it. I can move better. I can move easier. I can hit harder. I can do all of that and know that, you know, if I need to take game, I can do it. I don't have to wait for the proper presentation. A 223 will take a deer. If it's
in ideal conditions with a broadside shot, yeah, on a sunny day. Yeah, I agree.
I may not have that. And so I want to be able to do it quickly and easily. And I can do that with the scout rifle. Now my scout rifle, I have modified it. I removed the bipod. I lightened it up. My scout rifle lost about 8 ounces worth of weight.
That's quite a bit off an already light rifle. 8 ounces is nothing to sneeze at.
Yeah, well, that's what happens when you pull that flimsy little bipod off of a Steyr. but I've also added a suppressor, and I like hunting with a suppressor because it saves my ears. It means that I can hear the bullet impacting a deer, so I know what kind of a hit I just made. I like that. I like that whole package. So that would be my go-to right there.
And I got two more questions, if you will, just to pontificate on, and you don't have to have an answer, but granted, he talked about the 308, which I think is a fantastic round. And granted, he talked about the 7mm 08, which is also a fantastic round, and the 243. And we know bullet technology, like not quite as fast, but has come a long way in the past 10 years. So do you think that 6.5 Creedmoor would have fit his criteria?
Oh yeah, I think he would probably love the 6.5 Creedmoor in the place of a 7mm 08. Mm-hmm. I think he would probably still, for the universal availability of ammunition, would probably still prefer a 308.
Yeah,
but I think that in those jurisdictions where military cartridges are illegal, I think that the 6.5 Creedmoor would be a great choice.
Yeah, you know, I wasn't a big fan of the 6.5 Creedmoor. I was kind of against it for a long time. I thought it was the next hot caliber, and how they come out every year, two or three new calibers. And I was like, I stay away from those. But I was looking for my Kimber Adirondack, which, like, you talk about lightweight, even for a scout rifle, it weighs 4 point something pounds.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's super light. And the only caliber I could get it in, I wanted it in a 308. The only caliber I could get it in was a 6.5. And that thing's great. And that 6.5, I have taken quite a few different animals with it, pretty robust animals with it at different distances. Yep. And that caliber really impressed me. Again, bullet selection is important. You know, I'm not going to go hunting with FMJs or whatever unless I absolutely had to. But yep. I think that's I agree with you. I think that would fit right in. And if you're shooting a 150 grain bullet out of 6.5 Creedmoor, you get higher sectional density and higher ballistic coefficient than you're going to get out of a 308 of 150 caliber. So I think it does have some merit. And I think that you're talking about ammo availability. I think the 6.5 Creedmoor today is probably more common than 7mm 08 is, even though 7mm 08 is a great caliber.
Yep. Right.
So yeah, right. I would agree with that. So let's say you were going to, somebody said, okay, build me a scout rifle with an AR-15 platform, because that's the most common platform in America. Is there a caliber you could squeeze in there where you could make that work? Or if not, is there a caliber that comes close?
Not really.
Okay. You could say no. You could say like, no, that's garbage. That's a horrible idea.
Be more inclined to go with one of these lightweight these AR-10s. Super light. Yeah.
Okay, we can edit a bunch of that out, and we can just say for you, if you're going to do a scout on a semi-auto, you'd build it off the AR-10.
Yes.
And yep. I guess we should mention the one of the very first things that got you in contact with me is you dissented from my opinion that my SCAR 17 could be a scout rifle.
Yeah, no, I stick by that.
If I take the, even though I've got an LPVO on it, if I take the rails off and I can get it under 7.7, it's still not a scout?
Well,
you can call 7.7 with the rails.
Okay, with the scope?
No, that's why I have to take the rails off, and I could probably lighten the stock, which I'm just telling you, I'm not going to do that because it's a $4,000 rifle. But I guess I could probably buy it in a replacement stock. But if I could get it under 7.7 with an optic, would it be a scout?
Who cares? I don't want to sound too flippant on that, but
that's okay. Really,
who cares if it's called a scout, if it is or isn't by whoever's criteria?
What you're saying. Yeah.
Is it a general purpose rifle? Does it meet your needs? Does it do everything that you intend it to do?
Yeah.
Then go with it. Absolutely.
That's kind of what inspired that episode. My first episode ever on Gunfighter Life was about the modern scout rifle. And I agree with your statement there is that I got that rifle because at the time I was the commander of a tactical team and I wanted a gun that I could kick down a door with and do CQB with if I had to, but I could also do longer range stuff if I had to, and I could also hunt with it. Now I haven't because I have purpose-built hunting rifles. But if you said, hey, you got a free elk hunt in Wyoming that somebody's going to send you on, you got to take your SCAR 17, I'd be like, sweet. I wouldn't bat an eye. I know it's super accurate. I know I've got a good sling on it. I know the optic is solid. And I would, like you said, general purpose rifle, I'm like, fine, that's great. If I go coyote hunting tomorrow, I can take that rifle and kick down a door the day after that. Hopefully I don't have to. But if I'm doing it for a drill, no, you know, I'm fine with that too.
Right. Yep.
So, yeah, I like it, sir. I think unless you got anything else you want to close on, I think that's a good way to wrap it up. And I really do appreciate you. And if you want to just mention one more time your YouTube channel and your blog, and we'll roll it up.
Sure thing. Well, the blog is a blogger site under the username Cliffy109, Cliffy 109. And the YouTube channel, just search for Steve Clifford, and common spelling on that, just Clifford the Big Red Dog. that's the easy way people remember it. But yeah, subscribe to the YouTube channel. I upload content usually every 2-3 months. I'll put something else new up there. I'm always looking for new topics and things that I think people will be interested in. One of the ones that I'm a little bit more proud of is how to prepare for a scout rifle class. Go into, you know, preps, what kind of gun, what kind of ammo, what type of gear should you bring, what mentality, what is the prerequisites? How do you walk into it feeling like you know what you're doing? And that one turned out really well. And I had some good feedback from a lot of top level instructors on it. So I've got that one. I've got several on techniques like with the slings, with, you know, how to mount and install a Rhodesian sling and different things on scope. So a lot of decent content in there. If you're interested in scout rifles, I think you'll find some stuff to occupy yourself for a while.
Okay. That's great, sir. I appreciate that. We'll definitely put some links into the show notes in there. I'm not sure how many people read those, but hopefully they'll go in there and check that out. And then just a real quick recap, so let's say somebody listening is like, okay, you know, Cliff, you twisted my arm. I'm convinced I have to spend more money on guns and ammo and accessories. Your recommendation would be the Steyr Scout rifle with one of the Leopold Scout scopes.
Yes. Although if you decided you wanted to go with a Ruger, I would say have at it, man. That's still an excellent choice.
Okay. And then if you had to pick one of those slings, would you pick the Rhodesian? Would you pick the Ching sling?
Well, if I had the Steyr, I would go with the Ching sling. If I got the Ruger, I would go with the Rhodesian.
Because it already has the two sling swivels on it?
Correct.
Got it. All right. I think that's a great place to wrap it up. I appreciate you, sir. And well, I'm sure we'll stay in contact as you are. Thank you so much. I should say that you are one of the patrons, and I really appreciate that. If you don't want me to mention that, I'll take it out. But I really, like I said, I'm humbled that anybody listens, and I appreciate all your support.
Well, I enjoy your podcast. I mean, they are engaging. They get me to think. I don't always agree with you, but you know what? You get me to think. And
oh, that's yeah, I would not want anybody on this podcast that agree with me all the time, because that would mean that I'm not never wrong. And as my wife will tell you sitting in front of me, I am wrong quite often. So I'm not asking you to, I would never expect somebody to be a robot and disagree with everything that I say all the time. So. No.
All right. So a rare treat, having an awesome guest like Steve Clifford on the show. Also took out a lot of stuff from that. It was quite long. I thought something cool for this episode would be to put in a few bloopers, takeouts. All I'm going to say is if you want to, go to goodshepherdtraining.com, check out more. But mostly this I'm going to plug in, like I said, Steve's stuff and his YouTube channel in the show notes. So check that out. Thanks. Have a blessed day.
You're kind of an odd character. And I listened to the podcast and I think that's kind of weird. But then I realized I'm engaged with this. I'm engaged and I keep listening. And every time there's a new one that pops up, I always listen. And So you're doing something right. You really are. And so weird is working for you. So yeah, go with it.
So yeah. I'm very blessed that God's grown the podcast as much as he has. Like I said, when I uploaded it and I was like, Whatever happens, happens. And I figured if somebody out there was going to listen, it was worth it. And if you get blessed with a lot of talent and experience, it's not yours to keep, it's yours to share, which is what you're doing today. Yep. So,
yep.
Yeah. But will you hear me now?
Yep. Totally normal.
Tell me everything you know about scout rifles.
I know nothing about scout rifles.
You know the rifles.
Yep, and they're for scouts.
Nice. Done.
All right. It was a great episode. Thanks, everybody. Enjoy your day.
Hold on. I got to hit stop recording, don't I?